Welcome to the Dream Life is Real Life podcast with your host, Hannah Hermanson, bringing you real life stories of people who realized their dreams to educate and inspire you to create your legacy of abundance now.
Hey, hey, Hannah here, and today I'm back with Brandy Salazar. She knows firsthand how challenging it is to keep your marriage a priority while you're juggling careers and being a parent. She also knows that it's possible to be more in love than ever than before, like even while you're raising kids, you can be more in love. Because 4 short years ago, she was nearly divorced. Having kids abruptly deprioritized her marriage. When she thought about calling it quits, they made one last effort to save their relationship. She walks through the front door and she says to her husband, "Not only are we not getting divorced, but we're going to create the most amazing marriage that we possibly can." And so she used this time and her best efforts and found tools that other successful business and health coaches were using to integrate positive psychology methods and applied those concepts to their marriage. And their results were so effective that they applied the same method and principles to their family and brought their daughters along on the journey. Last year, they quit their 20-year careers, sold their dream home, and began homeschooling their daughters to have more dedicated efforts, more aligned with their missions. And today, she helps couples with kids everywhere create the most amazing and legendary relationships possible. Brandy, welcome.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Yeah. So that intro gave us a good snapshot of kind of the last 4 years and being a wife and a mother. And before we started recording, you shared a little bit more about your entrepreneurial journey or your story to get to this point of having a career that you want to quit after 20 years. So would you mind taking us back a little bit, what you were sharing with me, sort of, you know, how you got into the, you found financial success early, and I would love for the listeners to have a little bit more context in where exactly you're coming from.
So yeah, I did. I had one of those, you know, I don't know if it's unconventional or conventional these days, but really dysfunctional upbringing that I found myself on my own at 15 years old. And it was, you know, a fight or flight moment. Like, do you just, you know, shrivel into the abyss and, you know, go down a bad path, or do you step up and try to break this cycle? And, you know, luckily, by the grace of God, like whatever you want to call it, like I stepped up and got a job. And instead of just treating my job like a job, I went all in and I did everything that I could see that I could do or I could learn. And I did it to the best of my ability. And I got books and I, you know, read, you know, content on whatever I could to be better at, you know, whatever I was doing. And by the time I was 23, I made partner in the company that I was with and, you know, found financial success through that. And so the interesting part of my story is I still to this day, I'm almost 40 and I do not have a high school diploma. Hmm. And yet, you know, I have experienced a net worth of over $1 million since I was in my 20s. And so I always like to start with a story like that because my story is a story of hope for anyone. And it's also a story of, you know, what that type of upbringing can do to a detriment, even when you find financial success. Because, you know, as I went through this journey, I felt that, you know, I had made it in such a way that life was going to be wonderful and easy and, you know, butterflies and rainbows, right? Because what are we all trying to do? We're just trying to make enough money to have all the things to feel that we are successful in an external way. And, you know, during this career, I met my husband and we had 2 daughters. And, you know, the reality of building a family when you have a career in a business that is very demanding is that, you know, you can only split the pie so many ways.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. So Go ahead.
Yeah, before we get there, I want to dig into this piece of the story a little bit, because now I know so much of the work that you do is focused on building legendary couples and families. And so I'm curious, knowing a little bit about, you know, having a hard time in the marriage, almost ending it, when was it kind of a blur? Like, as you just sort of kind of said, we met, we had kids. Like, what is the beginning
of
the love story? And are there lessons that, you know, people who are just beginning a relationship or setting intentions for a marriage that you would share at that step of the game?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think that, and this is my opinion, when you first get married, it really doesn't feel much different than dating or being engaged. Not a whole lot changes. I mean, maybe you combine your finances at that point, you move in together at that point, you know, depending on what level you're at in your relationship before. But Lance and I had already lived together. We'd already purchased a house. We were so intertwined by the time we got married, there wasn't a big shift for us. We fell in love, and like, we both had our careers, and our off time was dedicated to each other. And so things were great until we had kids. We had our first daughter, and all of a sudden, you know, you have this full plate, right? We had busy schedules before we had kids. Mm-hmm. We had busy schedules when we met. And so then all of a sudden you have this human that, you know, you have to during the day when you want to get stuff done for work, where it's like, okay, in the beginning, I brought my daughter to work with me with a nanny, because I'm like, well, she's only 3 weeks old, you know, I can't really just dump her somewhere. Right. So I'm going to bring her with me. And so I tried that for a while, and, you know, and then there's the staying up at night because there's the lack of sleep. And then it's like trying to figure it out. Like, I've never been a parent before. My husband had never been a parent before. And as much as there are things you can do to prepare for parenthood, every single child is different. And every single couple comes to parenting with different tools and different, you know, baggage from our childhood and different, you know, ideals on what we think parenting should be. And so it just was a struggle for us. And that first year was really rough. And I, right out of the gate, just felt like I was failing everywhere. It was like, I felt like I was pulled in a million directions, and I could never like catch up time, where it was like, oh my gosh, I have these, you know, this, what I still have to do with the office. And then, oh my gosh. And then at the house, like, okay, now we need to hire a nanny, and now we need to hire more house help, and now I need someone to do our laundry. And so it's like, then I was like hiring all these people to like offset this dysfunction that I was like, you know, creating. Right. And so that does help, by the way. I will say that that is a tool, you know, is hiring people if you're in the financial space to do that. But if you're not, and even with me, when I was able to, there's an energetic, taxing, you know, I guess, like, you know, an energetic need that raising a child takes, but then you also still have this partner that you committed to, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I have this man that I married and I used to like him, like, you know, I want to still like him. And that, guess what that takes? That takes energy, and that takes my time and my heart space and my, you know, so I just found myself feeling like I didn't have what I needed to be able to make my marriage a priority and make my parenting a priority, because, you know, didn't come easy to me like business did. But you do, you know, when you say yes to something, I said yes to having a kid, I have to say no to something else a little bit. And it doesn't mean that you can't, I mean, I'm a boss mom, right? Like, I know that you can have a career and have babies. Like, I'm not saying that you can't, but, you have to be really intentional about how it's going to look. And, you know, maybe even with your career, like, get it to a place where you can start to say no to some tasks and some things that take your energy and take your, you know, time.
Right. And I mean, you're speaking to, I think, what a lot of women are always looking for, always talking about, sometimes lamenting, and that is the power of balance. And, you know, it's adaptable balance. When I was working 9 to 5 in small town Wisconsin and managing three other part-time jobs looks a lot different than, you know, balance in this era of my life when I'm traveling all the time, but having my own business and control over some of those things. So I love these. I'm hearing a few like principles that I'm pulling out here. And one of them is to be intentional and sort of aware. Okay, I said yes to these things. What are the things that are my priorities? And then on the other side of that is, you know, what knows or what delegation comes along with that. Does that sound
right? Like a good yeah, outsourcing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. That is.
Okay. All right. So so you outsourced, you made the decision, I'm just going to like my husband again, and you're off and running. Here we are. Or tell us
yeah,
more
no,
about
I wish.
Like,
yeah.
Tell us more
we
about
went to these, counseling. Okay. We were
yeah, yeah.
really trying to fix our relationship at that point. And, you know, we got it to enough of a place that we had our second kid, and holy Toledo, that, you know, and I don't think everybody's the same when it comes to having kids. You know, I have friends that they're like, oh, having children. And it just was like the light of my life and all of these things. And don't get me wrong. I love my daughters. They're, you know, 10 and 7 now, but those first years for me being somebody that is, you know, seemingly or just admittedly selfish. Like I like certain things. I like my time. I like to have quiet time. I like to have alone time. I like to be very focused without interruption on projects. Like I'm very intentional about my creation time and my creativity time. And
I'm so with you. Yeah.
Right. Like I'm starting something. I'm going to go ahead and sit down and build this project and wait, what? You're no. Mm-hmm. No, I need a minute. Like, mm-hmm. So I struggled with a lot of that. And, you know, that's not everybody's story, but I think entrepreneurial women, it is something that we struggle with that there, I think there should be less shame around it because, it is what it is, right? It's something that we have to adapt and figure out again, that word balance with. And so, you know, we had our second daughter and I had pretty severe postpartum depression because I felt like there was just absolutely no way that I was going to be, everything was overwhelming. Like, you know, when you're standing at the bottom of the stair and what you want is at the very top of the stairwell and you're like, I can't even see the stairs in between. I just know I can't jump that high. Mm-hmm. Like, how am I going to get out of this overwhelm? And so, you know, that was kind of the beginning of the end for my marriage. And, you know, because my business wasn't stopping and now I, you know, I have employees and all of these people that I, you know, I'm responsible for and investors and all this pressure. And then I have these babies that, I mean, it's like, they need me to stay alive, right? Like, I can't just be like, excuse me, I need to work on my marriage. Mm-hmm. You know, you're going to have to feed yourself and bathe yourself and all the things. And if you're crying, you got to figure that out. So, you know, the marriage again, abruptly deprioritized. And that time, you know, really put us on a path of it just, we never really caught back up after that. And, you know, I just, it's interesting because as much as I was busy and, you know, I had all of these things, I'd been in personal growth for a long time and I had all these tools and I had all these, you know, people and, you know, networks surrounding me where it's like goal setting and move forward and grow and be more and improve. And there was just something about my marriage that I just had this block and I was stuck. I could not figure out like, how do I fix this? Wait, he's not fixing like I'm telling him to fix. Like, right. Mm-hmm. I'm saying we need to do this and you need to do it. And this is what we're going to do. And it's going to be better. And, you know, it wasn't working. And so we got to a place where I asked him to move out and separating and all of that. So, that's the story to get to that point.
Yeah. If you could, I mean, it seems like you're still very much in touch with, that era of your life and you probably are helping women in this space now, but if you could just turn around, say something to Brandy with two toddlers, it sounds like they're close in age, you know, what would you say at the bottom of the staircase to yourself now?
First, I would say grace. You got to have grace because it's just crazy having two young children and some people have more. It's just hard. It's, you know, it's like, this is a horrible thing that I say and I may receive judgment from it, but it's like trying to, train drunk little people where you're like, where, what? No, we're doing this. Like, what are you, like, they're just, they're little and they really just are trying to figure themselves out. And I wish I had, and I have, you know, control issues. Clearly most people that are successful in business are mm-hmm. control freaks, super type A, right? Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, nope, we're doing this today. Wait, you're a kid and you're going that direction. I thought we were going this direction, you know? So have grace would be my first thing. And number two would be get really clear on your priorities, because at the end of the day, I chose to have these two little girls. And if I would have sat back and said, okay, I'm going to be adding these humans to my life that I want to raise and nurture to go out into the world and be the best little women that they could possibly be, what is that going to take from me? And I'm going to take it one day at a time. You know what? It needs a little more time. It needs a little more time. And I needed to back off my business a little bit, because at that point in my career, like, how much money do you really need? Like, mm-hmm. you know, I think there's a really interesting thing happening in our business world right now where it's like, you know, just keep going. And then, you know, now you're at eight figures and now you're at, okay, great. Sure. Wonderful. Now you have a jet. That's great. Okay. That buys you more time with your kids maybe on the plane. And I get it. And I was there for a long time, but at the end of the day, you know, love equals time. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that, you know, everybody should be a stay-at-home mom. That's not my makeup either. So I have grace for that. But I wish I would have stopped back then and said, you know what, I only have them little for 18 years.
Yeah.
I only actually have them little for like 5 or 6 years. Mm-hmm. And so I look back and I'm like, why was I pushing so hard for something? Like, you already had the $1 million house. You already had all the stuff, you know, like, right. What more did you need? Mm-hmm. And did you really even need all that? Because here's the interesting thing for me when it comes to this priorities. So, you know, like I said, we had multi-million-dollar lifestyle and we sold everything. And now I live in a 1400 square foot farmhouse with, you know, the four of us. Mm-hmm. And I'm more happy today than I was in that big fancy house.
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah.
I am. I have freedom now. You would think that that's seeking freedom to have all the stuff. Well, the stuff can be suffocating.
Absolutely.
If you don't have time.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Said another way. Not all of my clients have families or kids or even relationships, yet there seems to be these like external markers, right? Like you yes, said, markers. Do more, eight figures, do this, have this, buy mm-hmm. that, get a jet. Okay. And so here we are having really successful businesses, things that we used to be what we dreamed of. And, you know, clients are coming to me like, ugh, I only had a $20,000 month or, ugh, you know, only this. And it's like, hold on. First of all, let's not even look at numbers on a screen. Let's take a real evaluation of the life that you're living. And mm-hmm. is the lifestyle that you've built, like, what is that affording you? Like you said, okay, yes. Is it time on the jet that you really want? Or is it time at your farmhouse to be able to school your kids at home, right? And so right. I love this, like getting really clear on your priorities, not the benchmark right. you set out in front of your horse and buggy, but the things that are going to actually make you happy. And your story is such an example of that. Getting clear on priorities and changing the external.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And the interesting thing about this whole priority thing, and, you know, this is a vulnerable thing to say, but, you know, I built my life around what I thought would give me accolades and fit in and, you know, what other people's opinion was of me. And it really wasn't deep down like, yeah, I liked success. Sure. But at the core of me was a little girl trying to prove everybody wrong because I wasn't good enough without all the stuff, like, you know, growing up poor and having parents that were, you know, what they were and being homeless at 15, like I had something to prove to the world. And so me proving, that was my path to proving myself. And so it took me getting really honest with myself and saying, okay, what is it that you're like, where are you going here? What is it that you're trying to do? And so I had to realize that my definition of legendary, my definition of success had to come from me. And I had to stop worrying about what everybody else thought or what everybody else was doing. Why do I care what everybody else is doing?
Right.
It doesn't affect me. I mean, your success doesn't affect me. I mean, it's amazing, right? But I need to figure out what I really want. And that was where everything began to change.
Yeah, absolutely. So huge. What is your dream life? Yeah.
Yes.
So you have a new book out, which I really want to be able to talk about. So obviously, you know, I'm resonating with so much of your story, and I know a lot of other women listening will be resonating. So what is the book, you know, just about your story, or what else can we expect from reading the new book?
So the book is a Miracle Morning series book. So Hal Elrod wrote the original Miracle Morning. It's a fantastic book. That was one of the first things that really brought my husband and I together on our personal growth journey together. Because, you know, for a long time, I had my own personal growth journey. I was trying to drag him into a personal growth journey, kicking and screaming. And that's really common in relationships now that we're in this space. Like that is the norm, that one person is the driver in personal growth and the other one's like, what are you even doing? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, he got on his own personal growth path. And, you know, this book was the first thing that we both implemented together and that worked for both of us. And it's a simple morning routine called the Savers. And you do it before you start your day. So it's silence, affirmation, visualization, exercise, reading, and scribing, which is writing. And so all of that in 1 hour before you start your day. And it's unbelievable what happens in a very short period of time when you are that intentional before you start. And so Lance and I mean, long story short, we became friends with the author. And once we saved our marriage, we started adding things to our morning that helped move our marriage forward and helped keep us connected. And that was four simple steps that we called team, which is touch, education, where we either share something that we are individually learning or something new that we could learn about each other. A is appreciation, something like a piece of gratitude, like, hey, thank you so much for doing this yesterday, or I really appreciated when you did this. And then meeting, which is a quick check-in. Hey, how was I yesterday as a partner? Like, did I, you know, show up the way that we've now committed for me to show up? And then a quick check-in on our schedule. Hey, this is what I'm doing. You got the kids here. This is where I've got a podcast interview. I've got, you know, this going on now. You know, we're now two entrepreneurial couple, you know, homeschooling our kids. Oh, so yes. Yeah, it's a whole new juggle.
A farmhouse. Yes.
In a farmhouse. Yeah, okay. Right. Gardening.
I'm so with you. I'm eating this up right now. So I'm recently engaged and traveling full time. Like meaning we're together all the time in sometimes stressful situations. And something that my fiance and I have been doing for almost a year now is a Sunday check-in similar to this meeting. And yes. It's just based on feedback and evaluation models that we've seen. And so we'll ask each other on a scale of 1 to 10, how have I been as a partner this week? And okay, great. Thank you for that number. The good, the bad. Now what would make it a 10? We like forget all the time. And sometimes it's like, can we do 0.5? Right. So I just love this, like every day, you know, a few minutes
as just opposed quick. To
like yes. Sunday dinner, like big super quick. Meeting. Wait, what happened this week? And so, yeah, I'm totally going to take this to him. And I hope
but you know what's funny about the Sunday thing. And you guys are so way ahead. So if this was a podcast focused on relationships and you said to me, you know, what would you tell someone before they got married? And I would say exactly what you're doing right now. First, I would say, go get our relationship planning guide. It's free on our website. It talks about our four relationship elements, and I'll run through those real quick. But it talks about our four relationship elements, and in there is a weekly check-in. Because when you sit down on Sundays with yourself, okay, I teach women's balance courses and groups, and for everybody should be doing this. But if you were to check in on all of your pillars every single Sunday and say, okay, how did I show up for my self-care this week? How did I show up in my health this week? How did I show up in my faith? How did I show up in my relationships? How did I show up as a mom? How did I show up in my business? And you rate all of them. Mm-hmm. And then at the end of it, when you start to see them slipping and you said, you know what, my self-care went down this week because I was traveling a lot. Well, guess what? Your calendar gets a little more self-care time this week. Yes. You call and you cancel that podcast interview and you add in a massage or you add in a coffee with a girlfriend. And if you're that intentional and you do that every single Sunday, your life will change drastically, mm-hmm. very quickly. So the daily is just a quick check-in. And so it doesn't mean that you like add these big things to your calendar. That is what Sunday's for, or the, you know, first day of every month is another great time to do that. You know, we get these like, you know, transition points, I like to call them. Transition point of you're transitioning to a new month, you're transitioning to a new year, you're transitioning to a new week, transitioning in the morning, or little check-ins, right? And just say, hey, you know what, you said this yesterday in front of somebody and that hurt my feelings. And like, I would really prefer that you just tried a different tone, right? Okay, cool. Great. We don't need to talk about it. We don't need to like dive into all the details. Just great. Okay, quick check-in. I'm just going to make note of that. Don't get a bad tone in front of people, right? If we just made it that simple and that consistent, we wouldn't dwell on these things that go day over day where it's like,
build up.
4 days ago, you said we were going to have snuggle time and we didn't. And now I'm resenting you for 4 days and I don't know why we feel off. Well, it's because you waited 4 days, like, or 4 weeks, whatever it may be. And so that's where it really slips off. And then so those quick check-ins are a big, big deal if you can consistently do it, clearly. And the other thing is that let's say you don't, right? It, once you get into the habit of something, even if you fall off a little bit, you know how to reset. You know what to go back to. We all do it. It's like you can talk health, right? Oh, I know I'm supposed to work out every day. But if I don't work out for a week, it doesn't mean I never work out again. I now know what I need to do. Jump back on the train. So. Yeah. Yeah, that's what's great about it. But I'll touch on the four elements real quick because it is a really powerful thing for, you know, any couple, but especially I kind of wish that I focused more on newlyweds, because if I were to go back and know this, you know, when I was where you are, everything would be different. But the four elements are this. The foundation, it's like a pyramid. The foundation is you. So it's two of you that are happy, healthy, high emotional intelligence, solid confidence. Your, you know, health is good. And then the next element is your partnership. And this is life's basics. And this is where most couples get trapped. It's like, you know, we don't have the money to pay the bills, or who's taking out the trash, or you've got the kids, I've got the kids. Wait, I feel like I'm doing more than you are. You're not contributing as much as I am. Wait, you know, you're not as good at that as I am. So it's where we establish who does what the roles are, how our finances are going to go, how we're going to parent the kids, the basics. Because the reality is that if we don't have some of these basics done, then we're trapped there in worry and deprivation and feeling like our basic needs aren't met. So when we get that handled, you then move up to friendship. And this is where we have fun together. And this is where we have a deep knowing and enjoy our company. Quality time is here. Getting to know each other. This is really where the five love languages come in. Like, mm-hmm. what really makes you feel loved? And then the next one, once we feel like, okay, this is moving forward, then it's lovers. And this is where intimacy and vulnerability comes in. And so in order to have the depths of intimacy and vulnerability in relationships, all of these things have to be in order. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't mean they need to be perfect. They just mean that, and this is where we give our relationship planning guide course away for free because it's so important. All it is taking each one of those elements and simply saying, hey, just like you guys do on Sundays, if our friendship was at a level 10, what would that look like for you? What would that look like for me? And together, what would that look like for us together? Compromise here, add that in here. You know what? I've never tried that. I never thought about that. Let's try it together. Mm-hmm. And then you build a vision, a shared vision for your relationship that moves you guys forward, and you make small commitments that you say, you know what? This week, let's try this for our friendship. Next month, let's try this for our lover's element.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Oh, and the way that, and you know, we talk about being type A and a little bit control freaky. Yeah. I love, this gives such a structure to what, yes. you know, we do. Like I said, sometimes it's like, oh, hey, like, I don't know, 8.5. Why? I don't know. So this is really, really helpful for lots of relationships, I would imagine, but especially those really important, close, everyday relationships.
Right.
Wow. Okay. So many like tangible resources and like things people can be doing already. But I would just ask again, you know, is there any, if you could just be in our successful female entrepreneur friends' ears, is there kind of navigating relationships and balance? What would be just like that thing you wish you could put in everyone's ear? Kind of the last piece of insight.
I would probably say, don't be afraid to do what you really want to do, regardless if it is, you know, what everybody else is doing. You know, we all have this little knocking at our heart that says, you know what, this doesn't feel right. Or wait, I saw somebody do this and that kind of looks great. Like, what if I could do that? But we tend to get on these paths and don't think we could pivot. And life is just a series of pivoting until we find who we really are. And if I look back, you know, I'm going to be 40. If I look back, I just wish that I wouldn't have been so rigid and I would have just pivoted more and just said, wait, like this group of people, that feels good. Wait, like that new thing to add to my day feels good. Or I don't have to be like everybody else. Or, you know, just, I can just be me, because at the end of the day, it's our uniqueness that adds value to the world. It's not us all being the same. Like, we don't want this like vanilla bowl, right? We want the color and the vibrancy of life. And yet we're all just trying to mirror each other. We're all trying to do the same thing.
Permission to pivot, people.
Yes, permission to pivot all day long if you need to. Wait, that, like, I homeschool my kids now and people are like, so are you going to homeschool like forever? And I'm like, I don't know. Ask me tomorrow. We'll see.
Yeah. Yeah, I get that for sure. With traveling all the time. Like, I don't know. Yeah, it's how I'm operating for right now. So
great. Yes. Wow.
I am vibing with you so much, Brandy. And I know that a lot of women too, I will appreciate your vulnerability and the honesty and stories, but also, you know, the upside, right? And not to dwell in your hard times, but to make those decisions, like you said, we're gonna actually make this struggle into our strength. So how can people stay connected with you, grab a copy of the book, and yeah, get involved with legendary couples?
The book is The Miracle Morning for Couples, and it's on Amazon or Audible. And our website, which is where you can get that free relationship planning guide, is legendarycouples.com. And I hang out mostly on Instagram. That's my jam. We do have Facebook and all of that too, but I'm Miss Brandy Salazar, MRS Brandy Salazar, and we have Legendary Couples as well on Instagram.
Amazing. All right. Well, everyone, I totally encourage you to take advantage of those resources and stay connected, because together is how we make our dream life our real life. So I will be back next week with another inspiring guest. And until then.
You've been learning how to make your dream life your real life with Hannah Hermanson. To get the resources mentioned on today's show and to listen to past episodes, visit www.dreamlifeisreallife.com.